Good morning po sa lahat ng mga criminology students from Luzon, Visayas, and Mindanao. Especially yung mga criminology students na first year pa lang, mga baguhan po sa criminology program. Magandang umaga po sa inyo. Yung mga reviewees po natin, kumusta na po yung mga lecturers natin in various review centers nationwide, mga professors, mga instructors, part-time, tsaka guest lecturer. Magandang umaga po sa inyo and welcome po again sa discussion natin sa Bikweno. Ang Bikweno po, isang platform natin sa YouTube na nagbibigay ng libre, ha, libre, free, recorded video discussions. Lahat libre yan. No need to pay anything. Ito po ang ligasiya ng Bikweno na makapagbigay ng libre na discussion. So, no need to pay anything. You can access po sa lahat ng mga video discussions. Yung mga walang pera po, na walang pang-enroll sa mga review centers, ito po ang pagkakataon that you have to take. All you have to do is just to access the channel. So, no need to pay anything, ha. Marami kasi po ang nagtatanong, sir, pwede bang magbayad kami in order to gain access on some other videos? No need po. Andyan na po lahat, ha. Free po yan. Free access po yan 24/7. Unlike other platforms that you have to pay an amount para makapag-access. Pero sa atin po, tulong na po sa mga financially challenged na mga estudyante. Tulong na din po sa kapos po sa pera, ha? So, anyway, kahit knowing na libre, mas comprehensive pa. Diba? Other channels are not doing this. Pero dito po sa Bikweno, I could assure to you, lahat ng discussions align with the table of specification plus very comprehensive yung discussion po natin. Okay? Now, sa episode 1, na-highlight po natin ang 3 main schools of thought. Una, yung classical. Pangalawa, neoclassical. Pangatlo, positivist or Italian school. We also made mentioned in episode 1 yung mga branches or divisions of criminology, pati na yung definition kung ano ang criminology, ang nature or characteristics ng criminology, at pati na yung mga allied studies ng criminology. Okay? Now, sa contemporary times po natin, may mga other schools being created. For example, itong social psycho school. Okay? Ang school po na ito takes a look on social factors as main causes of criminality. Social factors such as, number one, poverty, subcultures, level of education, and other cultural forces. And usually, this school emphasizes on the theory of imitation in crime causation. Ang mga proponents po natin, sina Edwin Sutherland. Sino ba si Edwin Sutherland as mentioned in episode 1? Ito po, ang tao na ito is tinatawag na Dean of Modern Criminology. Siya po ang Dean of Modern Criminology. Then, we have Emily Durkheim, Gabriel Tard, Thorstein Selin. Alright? Unahin natin si Edwin Sutherland, yung Dean of Modern Criminology. Okay? Siya po ang founder sa teorya na tinatawag nating differential association theory. Ang differential association theory simply means that criminal behavior is learned through association with the society. Again, yung criminal behavior po natin is learned through association or how we associate ourselves with the groups of the society. Let us say, for example, if we choose to associate ourselves with a group of people that are alcoholic, time will come, we will develop the attitude of being an alcoholic. If we will associate ourselves with the gamblers, of course, time will come, we will develop the attitude of being a gambler. On the other hand, if we will associate ourselves with a group of people that are drug addicts, of course, time will come. We will also become drug addicts. Diba? So, ang criminal behavior po is learned the way we mingle with the society, the way we associate ourselves with the society. At tawag po dyan, differential association theory. Pangalawang tao is Emily Durkheim. Ang kay Emily Durkheim naman, siya yung founder o nag-establish sa tinatawag nating anomie theory. Anomie from the word ah. Ah means absence. Okay? Absence. Ah means absence. Nomie, on the other hand, refers to the standards of the society or the norms. Okay? When I say norms, I am referring to the standards of the society. Let us say, for example, yung being respectful towards our parents. Norms po yan. I think I mentioned this one in episode, in the first episode, di ba? Pag norms, standards po yan sa society. These are not written rules, but these are considered as cultural laws or unwritten rules and regulation. Bakit unwritten? Kasi hindi po ito nakasulat sa batas. Hindi nakasulat sa batas. But we know that this standard should be observed. For example, sa mga Pinoy, being respectful, being generous. Pag pumasok tayo sa bahay, di ba? Pag pumasok tayo sa bahay, tapos may mga elders, ano po ang gagawin natin? Ang gagawin natin is to get the hand of the elderly, tapos ilagay natin sa forehead natin. Or we say, good afternoon, good evening, or good morning, pag pumasok tayo. Walang batas na nagsasabi na pag pumasok ka, tapos hindi ka nakapag-good morning, ay arestuhin ka at ilagay sa kulungan. Wala pong batas na nagsasabi na ganyan. Kasi po, ang pag-greet po, saying good morning, good afternoon, is basically our standard in the society known as the norms. So basically, when you say anomie, absence of the standards in the society or absence of norms. It suggests that complicated industrialized societies promote isolation of the individual. People became specialized in their activities and are expected to survive on an individual rather than group basis. So anomie is a condition in which society provides little moral guidance to individuals. It is the breakdown of social bonds between an individual and the community. So, una po, again, when we say anomie, mangyayari lang po ang absence of the standards or breakdown of the norms pag there is too much industrialization within the society. Sobra-sobra po yung pagka-industrialize, di ba? There is a big difference between living in the city and living in a rural area. Kasi pa ako, nakatira pa ako sa rural area eh. May eskwelahan po sa rural area. I was able to teach in that school. Nang nag-transfer ako sa syudad, doon ako nagturo, there's a very big difference. Because in a rural area, the moment you call a particular student, pagtawagin mo po yan, the person will run and will go to you and will say, the person will almost bow and will say, sir, good morning. And without asking, the student will even carry your bag. Or sometimes they will ask for the keys sa opisina. They will say, sir, can I open the door? Can I open the office for you? Yun po. They're very courteous. Pag nasa rural area po. Nung nag-transfer ako sa syudad, nako, I was, let us say for example, one experience po, I was bringing with me a polygraph machine. Tapos yung criminology department na doon po ako mag-conduct ng klase, nasa third floor. Imagine, walang elevator yan. Third floor. I was carrying from the ground floor a polygraph machine. Mga 5 kilos siguro, 5 to 6 kilos. Napakabigat nun. And along with the polygraph machine, I was carrying with me my bag and the books for instructions, lahat po. Dinadala ko. I was carrying different loads po with me. Pero nang umakyat pa ako papuntang third floor, nako, ni isang criminology student walang tumulong. They will just ask you, sir, ano po ba yan? And you will respond, this is a polygraph machine. And they will just say, okay po sir, I'll go ahead. So basically, iba po kasi ang disiplina, to be honest with you, iba po ang disiplina sa rural areas compared to these urban areas in cities. So mga industrialized places po. Iba po ang level of discipline at iba po ang level of respect. Sabi ng ano may theory, mangyayari po yan pag industrialized po ang isang society. Pangalawa po, nagiging specialized na po tayo sa mga activities po natin. Okay? So, we are expected to survive in our independent manner rather than relying in a group basis. So, ang ano may again, kulang yung moral guidance, nagka-breakdown sa standards, tapos yung social bonds, yung connection natin bilang isang tao from one person to the other has already been broken. So pag wala na po ang standards sa society, wala na pong guidance, okay? Wala na pong guidance, and without this guidance, moral guidance, possibly po na mga tao will become delinquents. Yun po ang anomie theory. Next, the other one is Gabriel Tarde. Siya po ang proponent sa tinatawag nating imitation suggestion theory. So sabi po dito, ang delinquency and criminal matters are learned and adapted. Okay? Ang sa kanya po, ang learning process may either be through copying, conscious copying, or unconscious copying. Yung conscious type of copying, you consciously imitate somebody's behavior, okay? You imitate. On the other hand, pwede pong unconscious copy or tinatawag yung suggestion of confronting pattern of behavior. So, yun po ang imitation suggestion theory. Ang pinagkaiba po dito sa differential association is that yung differential association, yung behavior is learned through association with the members of the society or with the groups of the society. Pero sa imitation suggestion theory, it plainly states na ang learning po mangyayari either be imitating, conscious copying, or unconscious copying, or yung tinatawag nating suggestion. The other one is Thorstein Selin. Ano po ba ang contribution ng taong ito? Ang sa kanya naman, conflict of culture theory. Ano ba ang conflict of culture? This asserts na yung multiplicity of incompatible cultures is the main source of social disorganization. Bakit disorganized yung society natin? Iba-iba kasi yung kultura. Di ba? Yung kultura ng Muslim at kultura ng Kristiyano, iba yan eh. Di ba? Even our religion, various religious organizations, di ba nagdidibate? Seventh-day Adventist versus Catholic, Catholic versus born again versus Iglesia ni Cristo versus other religious sects, di ba? So, hindi po, wala pong agreement, not in a consonance, not in harmony with each other. Much more, pag ang racial culture po is iba-iba. Kasi po ang kultura ng Ilonggo at kultura ng Cebuano, iba po yan. Ang kultura ng Cebuano at kultura ng mga Tagalog, iba din po. Ang kultura ng mga Tagalog na Tagaluzon, iba din po yan sa kultura ng mga Bicolano. Ang kultura ng mga Bicolano, iba din po ang kultura sa Waray. So, pag incompatible, sabi dito, that can cause social disorganization. Okay? Next, other contributors in criminology, we have the following. Number one, Alphonse Bertillon. O mga kadete, first year. Si Alphonse Bertillon po, siya po ang pinakaunang tao nag-establish ng form of identification. Ang tawag po nito, itong tinatawag nating anthropometry. Noong una po, tinatawag yung Bertillonage. Okay? Bertillonage in recognition of his family name. Pero pinalitan po, pareho lang po yan, Bertillonage or anthropometry. Okay? So sa kanya naman, yung pag-formulate niya ng identification system, binabase niya sa physical measurements of the person. Pero huwag niyong kalimutan, ang measurement na mga ito will be based kung ano yung measurement, for example, ng number one, height mo, the distance between your eyes and your ears, the distance between your eyes and your mouth, yung waistline mo, yung size ng head mo, lahat po ng sizes kinukuha. Kasi po, Alphonse Bertillon believed that even though you have the same height, you may differ in terms of the size of the head. Or probably, you may differ in terms of the distance between the mouth and the eyes. May pagkakaiba po. Sabi niya, lahat po ng height po, lahat po ng measurements natin or yung measurements po natin na physical is actually unique po. So, remember, ang anthropometry or birth units again, ito po ang pinakaunang scientific system na ginagamit po sa identification of criminals. Pero, as time goes on po, napalitan po itong anthropometry or birth units kasi po, napaka-taxing yan eh. Napaka-stressful. Imagine, you will be measuring everything. You will be measuring the physical features of the person. It will take a lot of time. Compared to fingerprint identification, all you have to do is to get the roll impression and plain impression of the fingerprint and you are done. Napakadali lang. Sa Bertil Lineage, systematic siya, scientific at the same time, pero mas matagal. It's taxing actually. Alright, yan po ang contribution ni Alphonse Bertillon. Pangalawang other contributor, itong si William Adrian Bunger, isa po siyang Dutch criminologist na nagsasabi na may relationship po or may link po between crimen and economic and social contributions. He asserted that crime is social in origin and a normal response to the prevailing cultural conditions. Okay? Next! Other contributor naman, itong si Adolf Kittilet. Si Adolf Kittilet naman, siya po ang gumamit ng data and statistical analysis para malaman po yung relationship between crime and sociological factors. Yung relationship, ano bang relationship ng krimen at saka yung sociological factors? Sociological factors such as yung edad, yung gender ng tao, yung poverty, at saka yung education. Ano ba ang relationship? Okay, si Adolf Kittilet po ang gumawa niyan. Next, contributor, itong si Charles Goring. Ang kay Charles Goring naman, 3,000 convicts. Inistudyuhan niya ngayon yung, imagine, 3,000 convicts. He studied the mental characteristics of this person, these persons. Tapos, he made a conclusion na there is a relationship daw sa krimen at saka sa tinatawag nating defective intelligence. Ibig sabihin, ito po yung mga taong suffering from feeble-mindedness, insanity, and defective social instinct. Ha? Kulang po or medyo apektado po yung intelligence nila. Defective po yung intellectual factor ng isang tao. Sabi niya, pag ang tao has defective intelligence, they are prone to commit criminality. Tapos ang pinakamasakit po dito, itong sabi niya ha, ang criminal characteristics daw are considered to be inherited. And that people with such traits should not be allowed to reproduce. Okay? Sabi niya, di daw pwede. Kung kumari po, bawalan po sila mag-reproduce. Magparami. Okay? So, dapat po hindi sila ma-pregnant. Dapat po hindi ma-reproduce. Pag defective yung intelligence or yung person has criminal characteristics. Yan po ang sabi ni Charles Goring nung pinag-aralan niya po yung mental characteristics ng 3,000 ng mga convicts. Okay? Next, the other one is Albert Cohen. Ang kay Albert Cohen naman, siya yung nag-advocate, nag-establish na tinatawag nating subculture theory and delinquency theory. He includes the explanation of prevalence, origin, process, and purpose as factor to crime. The other contributor, we have Irving Goffman and Howard Beaker. Siya po ang founder ng labeling theory. Actually, ang mga theories ng mga ito, I discussed this very comprehensively on the theories of crime causation. Ano ba ibig sabihin ng labeling theory? Okay? The theory maintains that interaction causes them to behave criminally when one or both interpretation of the meaning of such interaction is wrong. So it's very simple. Para po maintindihan, ganito po ang labeling theory. The moment you call somebody with a negative name, okay? Mali po yung label na binigay mo. For example, you will say, boy sunog, right? Or you will say, boy kawatan. But in reality, the person is not a kawatan, okay? He's not a thief. But you keep on labeling him as a thief. Or the society might label the person as a thief, but in reality, he is not. I tell you, time will come, darating ang panahon, na ang bata will live in accordance with the label. Bakit po? So, magiging magnanakaw siya ngayon. Bakit po? Kasi, he will be irritated with the negative label coming from the society. So, sabi niya sa sarili niya, so why not become a thief? Because, knowing that the society already labeled me as one, so why not become a magnanakaw? So, labeling po. Pangalawa, sa labeling theory po, if we label a person with negative names, they become easily irritated to the point that they will resort to criminal behavior or criminal acts. Okay? Yan po ang labeling theory. Next one, itong Charles Darwin. Okay? Very common yan. Nasa science po natin ito since grade 1. So, si Charles Darwin po ang sabi na ang tao po is nagsimula sa unggoy. Nako, I do not believe on it. But for discussion sake, siya po ang founder ng evolution theory. That we come from a species, this species basically yung mga apes po, mga unggoy. So sabi niya, we are a parasite and has animalistic behavior. Take note, cadets, ang atavism po ni Edwin Sutherland, yung born criminal o atavism. Ano ba yung atavism? These are persons with physical anomalies such as flat nose, long jaw, black complexion, curly hair. Di ba yung na-discuss natin sa episode 1? Ang actually si Sir Lambroso kasi was an avid fan of Charles Darwin. Okay? Idol niya kasi si Charles Darwin. So that is why yung atavism niya was actually an inspiration coming from evolution theory. Sabi niya, yung mga atavistic persons, these are persons na underdeveloped, does not fully evolve. Kasi they do not fully evolve, they have with them the so-called animalistic behavior. Yun po ang sabi ng ni Cesar Lambroso. So again, ito ha, Charles Darwin, yan po ang contribution niya. That we are a parasite and has animalistic behavior. Next, there are early explanation of the causes or existence of crime. Ito po ang mga sinaunang teorya that will explain criminality. Una po dito, itong tinatawag nating demonology. Okay? Demonology theory. Sabi ng demonology, crime is caused by a demon. For short, ang tao po will commit criminality because he is possessed by the devil spirit. Okay? Possessed po siya sa devil spirit. Yun po ang sabi ng demonology theory. Pero again, yung demonology theory po, in our contemporary times, hindi po natin na binigyang diin yan. We do not follow it. We do not believe in it. Even the court will not believe in it. Bakit po? Because ang korte po natin will not accept any form of spiritual evidence. Ang ina-accept po ng korte natin yung mga scientific form of evidence. Hindi pwede that you will go to the court and you will say, Your Honor, I should be exempted from punishment because when I raped the woman, yung kamay ko gumalaw eh. Nadimunyuhan, gumalaw. You cannot say it in the court. Even if you will say, Your Honor, I am possessed by the devil, I should not be liable. You cannot say it. That will not be acceptable in the court because the court does not accept any form of spiritual evidence. Ang ina-accept po kasi ngayon ng korte yung scientific, tangible evidence that are considered to be scientific or any evidence that will address to the five senses that are considered to be scientific. But in as far as nadimonyuhan yung kamay, gumalaw, nako. Hindi yan acceptable sa korte. Pero demonology theory, sabi dito, crime is caused by the devil spirit or by the demon. And those persons who commit it are possessed by an evil spirit. Next, The other one is divine will theory. From the word divine, ibig sabihin, nasa taas po yung Panginoon. Okay? That refers to God. Okay? So sabi po dito sa divine will theory, ang tao po or ang krimen po has to be committed because it is the divine will of God. Okay? In Cebuano, pagbuot sa Ginoo. Okay? When we say pagbuot, that is the will of God. Ibig sabihin, nangyayari ang krimen kasi galit ang Panginoon, kasi yung mga tao are sinners. Mga makasalanan po. So in order to punish these sinners, dapat po crime will be committed in order to punish these people. So yan po ang ibig sabihin ng divine will theory. Number 3, crime is a matter of retribution. A long time ago, when you say retribution, ibig sabihin vengeance. Okay? Vengeance po or revenge. So, nakumit ang krimen as a matter of revenge. Pangapat, crime is equal to sin. This is another explanation of crime along in the previous years. So, ano bang ibig sabihin sa phrase na crime is equal to sin? Ano ba ang pinagkaiba ng krimen at saka yung sin? When we say crime, it is a violation of our human law or human laws. But when we say sin, it's a violation of the divine laws. Mga batas po ng tao ang na-violate, krimen po ang tawag. Pero pag ang batas na na-violate is yung batas ng Panginoon, ang tawag po niyan, sin. Pero bakit ang sabi dito, crime becomes a sin? Crime is equal to sin. Now, everyone is familiar with the Ten Commandments. Diba? Sa Bible po, sa second book, Exodus, book of Exodus chapter 20. Sa mahilig magbasa ng Bible. Sa di mahilig po, can you read the Bible? I would encourage you to read the Bible para malaman nyo po ang katotohanan. Do not rely too much on your pastors, on your priest to tell you about the truth, because sometimes the truth is a lie. So, I want you to see it for yourself kung ano po ba ang katotohanan. Ha? Sa mga nagdidibati dyan, na mahilig magdibati, ha? Mga criminologists na mahilig sa magdibati ng Bible, magdidibati sa religion, magbasa kayo, ha? Genesis up to Revelation. Ay, naku, na-revolution na. Revelation. Magbasa kayo. Ha? So, sa second book ng Old Testament, sa Exodus, chapter 20, andun yung Ten Commandments. Kindly judge or evaluate. Evaluate yourself kung na-follow ba. Ang sabi po dyan, thou shall not kill, thou shall not steal, you have to remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you shall work, but on the seventh day you shall rest. Isa po yung commandment, ha? Sabi dyan, dapat i-remember mo, dapat you have to keep the Sabbath day as a holy day. Yan po ang pangpitong araw. Ang pangpitong araw po is Sabado, hindi po Domingo, hindi po Sunday, ha? I am not trying to doctrinize you in this video, ha? Pero yan po ang katotohanan. Sabi po dyan, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you shall work, but on the seventh day you shall rest. Ibig sabihin, dapat mag-rest ka, pumunta ka sa church, doon ka magsimba ka on the seventh day. Ang tanong ngayon, ano bang seventh day? Ang seventh day of the week is hindi Domingo. Saturday po yan. Holy po. Ha? So, basahin natin ang Bible, ha? So, sabi doon, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy, thou shalt not make any graven image before me. Huwag kang maglikha na kung ano-ano dyan at i-worship mo. Ha? Thou shalt not kill. Thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's wife. Thou shalt not steal. Respect your parents. Yung mga lahat-lahat po ng mga commandments inilagay sa Exodus chapter 20. Now, pag thou shalt not kill, ang killing po is not allowed basically. Right? It's a divine law. It's part of the Ten Commandments. Pag tumingin tayo ngayon, sa batas ng tao, may batas din po tayo na nagsasabi na ang pagpatay is considered to be illegal. Am I correct? Murder, homicide, parricide, di po yan allowed. So basically, ang killing is under the law of God and under the law of man. So basically, kasi makikita ang thou shall not kill sa Bible at killing, which is also prohibited under the law of man, crime now is considered to be equal to sin. Okay? Kasi pag pumatay ka ng tao, nagkasala ka sa mata ng Diyos. That is a sin. Pag pumatay ka ng tao, hindi ka lang nagkasala sa Panginoon, nagkasala ka din sa batas ng tao. So, batas ng Diyos at batas ng tao ang binaviolate mo. Kaya po, nakasabi dyan, nagiging equal na. Crime is equal to sin. Pero pag ang batas po, does not violate the laws of man, but only violates the law of God, ang nakomit mo is only sin. Alright? Ang nakomit mo is only sin. For example, yung sabi ko nga kanina, remember the Sabbath day, it's a sin. Kasalanan po na hindi natin binigyan ng kabanalan yung sabi ng Diyos na dapat gawing banal po ang ikapitong araw ng simana, ha? So yan po. So sa mga curious dyan, ha, you can read the Bible. Magbasa kayo, mga kadete, magbasa kayo. Next, types of explanation to criminal behavior. Tatlo po, ha, single or unitary cause. Napakaisip pong intindihin ito. Single or unitary, from the word single or unitary, ang crime is only caused by one factor lang. It could be biological, social, or mental. Isa lang pong factor ang considered to be the cause of criminality. Pangalawa, itong multiple factor theory, from the word multiple, marami. Okay? Marami po ang factors na nakapag-influence in the commission of criminality. On the other hand, electric theory naman, pag pwede siyang one factor or many factors po na nakakos ng criminality. Okay? Next, biological causes of crimes, particularly on heredity. Ano bang ibig sabihin ng heredity? Ang criminal behavior is inherited from our parents. Okay? So, may tatlong family studies po. First year cadets, take note. Itong family studies, importante po na ma-memorize nyo po ito. Kasi you will have to remember this until you will take the board examination. Now, tatlo pong family studies. Una, itong Duke Family Tree. Sa Duke Family Tree, mga kadete, which was researched by Richard Dugdale, made known na ang criminal behavior po can be inherited. Ang ginawa po kasi ni Richard Dugdale, nag-trace siya ngayon sa pamilya ng mga Duke. Okay? Sa pamilya ng mga Duke, which consisted of 6 girls, some of whom were illegitimate. Okay? Tapos, sa anim po na miyembro ng Duke Family Tree, isa po dyan, itong tinatawag natin si Ada Duke. Okay, si Ada. Si Ada Duke, tinatawag po siyang mother of criminals. Okay, mother of criminals, ha? Pag lumabas sa board examination, mother of criminals, walang iba. Ang sagot po dyan is Ada Duke. Pero ang kumpleto pong label niya is Margaret, the mother of criminals. Yun po, Margaret, the mother of criminals. Question, bakit tinatawag siyang Margaret? Ganito po kasi ang nangyayari. Ang Ada Duke po is a pseudonym. Ano ba ang ibig sabihin ng pseudonym? In Cebuano, it's an angga. It's a fictitious name. Hindi po totoo na nag-exist ang pangalan na Ada Duke. Kasi po sa research po, we do not divulge the name of our participants. Okay, we cannot divulge it because we have to protect the confidentiality of information. So, ang ginawa ni Dugdale, yung 6 na mga girls who were mostly illegitimate, nilagyan niya ngayon ng mga pseudonyms or fictitious name. Alphabetical po yan. Yung una, si Ada Joke. Yung pangalawa, si Belle Okay? I forgot the third and the up to the sixth. But yung una po is si Ada. Yung pangalawa, Bell. Ining A, Ada. B, Bell. But these are fictitious names. So si Ada Joke concentrated on the descendants of... si Dugdale po concentrated on the descendants of Ada Joke. And after tracing, he found out that out of the 700 descendants, 181 of it are prostitutes. Imagine na, mga prostitutes. 142 are poopers. Ano ba ibig sabihin ng poopers? Yung nagmamalimos. Those persons who will ask for alms. And 106 illegitimate birth. He, however, concluded that heredity has a role in mental and physical aspects and that behavior is shaped by environmental factors. Ano sabi dito? Sabi niya, yung mental and physical aspects, nanggagaling po yan sa heredity. Pero may role din po ang environmental factor sa behavior po natin. So sabi niya, ang conspiracy ng environment at heredity is consequential to an antisocial family. For short, yung ina at yung ama, ha, maladimonyo, of course yung anak will become a maladimonyo also. Plus, this person or this child is living in an environment filled with demon-like characters or demon-like individuals. Nako, of course, the person will become more demonized. Magiging evil yan, magiging delinquent. Pag ang ina is a Maritis, yung ama is a Maritis, of course, the son or the daughter will become a Maritis. Plus, he is living in an environment filled with alcoholics, gamblers, and Maritis. Of course, the antisocial behavior will become more complex. So, yun po, joke family tree po yan. Sunod, kalikak family tree. Kalikak family tree is different. Kasi po, dito, it involves Martin Kalikak, a war soldier. Okay, a war soldier po. Itong si Martin Kalikak was actually married. Okay, married po siya. Siguro, he was assigned on a particular place. Tapos, alam mo naman yung buhay na magiging sundalo. Diba? Country first yan, before family. Makauwi ka sa inyo, sparingly lang po. In random lang, probably in 1 year, makauwi ka. Siguro, 1 month vacation lang or several weeks. So siguro, for several months, hindi po nakauwi ito si Martin Kalikak. So nagiging tigang. Natigang na si Martin Kalikak. So pumunta siya ngayon sa bar. Alright? Pumunta siya sa bar. Pagpunta niya sa bar, andito yung maganda na waiter. Diba? Parang artista. Artistahin po, ang ganda, ang cute. Pero, ang waiter na ito is actually was actually a feeble-minded. Kulang-kulang po, may defective in terms of the intelligence. Feeble-minded eh. But he fell in love with a feeble-minded woman. So, yung asawa niya na una, na Quaker, we say Quaker, it's a religious organization po. Hindi alam that this Martin Kalikak, her husband, had an illicit relationship with a feeble-minded woman. Unfortunately, time came, nagiging pregnant yung feeble-minded woman. So, ang ginawa ngayon ni Henry Goddard, nag-trace siya ngayon sa family tree ni Martin Kalikak with his descendants sa Quaker woman, yung good side ng family. Kasi good standing po yung wife niya. So, pag-trace doon, walang law violators. Lahat po, law-abiding citizens and ideal persons po. In the first, trace niya sa family tree with the Quaker woman and Martin Kalikak. Pero pag after that, tin-trace niya ngayon yung ka Martin Kalikak and the feeble-minded woman. Pag-trace niya ngayon, iba yung resulta. Kasi ang resulta ganito po. About 489 descendants from this lineage were traced, which included 143 feeble-minded, then 46 only people which are normal, 36 were illegitimate, 3 epileptics, 3 criminals, it kept brothels. When you say brothels po, ito pong den for prostitution, 82 died in infancy. So, basically, iba po yung good side at saka yung bad side. Yung good side po is yung descendants ni Martin Kalikak with the Quaker woman, at saka yung bad side po is yung kay Martin Kalikak with the feeble-minded woman. So it's different. So again, heredity plays an important factor. The last one is yung kay Sir Jonathan Edwards family tree, which was also traced. Si Edward po kasi was known to be a preacher. Tsaka yung asawa niya po was known as a teacher. So, trinrace niya ngayon yung family tree ni Jonathan Edward. And lo and behold po, ang ganda po ng resulta. Kasi po, sa mga descendants po, wala pong criminal nga nakita. Tapos, yung iba po ng mga descendants, nagiging presidente pa ng mga eskwelahan, presidente sa United States, nagiging governor, famous writers, preachers, and teachers. So, basically, ang ganda po ng lineage niya. To make the explanation very short, ang heredity plays an important factor po sa criminal behavior ng isang tao. Sabi kasi ng research, ganito po eh, sa mga kadete po, you have to select your future wife in a very systematic manner po. Systematic and scientific as much as possible. Sa mga lalaki dyan, ganito po kasi. According to research, 70% of our physical appearance will be inherited sa anak po natin, sa mga lalaki ha. Sa mga babae naman, 70% of your intelligence will be inherited. For short, ang kagwapuhan po, ang itsura po, will be inherited coming from the father, but the brain, ha, yung intellectual capacity ng tao, yung IQ, will be inherited from the mother. Ano ba ang perfect combination according to science? Ang perfect combination, ganito po sa mga kadete, sa mga single po dyan, be scientific ha. Perfect combination, pag lalaki ka, you look for a woman that is intelligent. I-prioritize nyo yung babaeng may alam, mautak, intelligent. Prioritize nyo yung intelligence over the beauty. Kasi pag ang jowa mo, maganda nga, pero mahina naman ang utak. Naku, ang resulta dyan, ang bata mo could be probably inherit the same IQ with the woman, with the lady that you are going to marry. On the other hand, sa mga lalaki, sa mga babae naman, prioritize yung pagiging handsome ng mga lalaki over their intelligence. Bakit po? Kasi ang intelligence anyway will be inherited coming from you. Ang handsome, being handsome, yung kapugihan ng mga lalaki, yun po ang ma-inherit ng bata. For short, pag ganito yung combination, yung babae, pangit, pero bright. Yung husband na lalaki, medyo kulang-kulang, defective yung intelligence, hindi masyadong mautak, pero pogi naman. Ang resulta dyan, ideal pa rin. Ang resulta, yung bata is handsome or beautiful and intelligent. Okay, kuha niyo po. Pero, pag opposite po yan, ha? Bibigyan ko kayo ng clue ha, para si scientific yung pag-search nyo. Pero pag opposite yan, yung lalaki, medyo yung lalaki is mautak pero medyo pangit, yung babae is maganda pero mahina yung utak. Ano ang resulta? Ang resulta diyan, bata na pangit na yung intelligence is not that good. So, yun po. Ang worst diyan, kung pangit ka pa, tulbuts ka naman. 'Di ba? So, selection is very important, mga kadete. It's very important. Why? Because according to heredity, again, criminal behaviors will be inherited. In the same manner, yung gifts, yung talents, yung intellectual capacity of the person will also be inherited. But then again, 70% of the appearance comes from the father, 70% of the intelligence comes from the mother. Okay? Next. Other two studies is on physiognomy and phrenology. Pag physiognomy po, ibig sabihin dyan, study of official features of a person in relation to his criminal behavior. Ibig sabihin dyan, titingnan ngayon kung ano yung shape ng ears mo, kung ano yung mata mo, ang distansya ng mata at saka ng nose, tapos i-interpret po yan. Yung facial features ng isang tao. Physiognomy po ang tawag. For example, pag arrogant nose po, arrogante yung ilong mo. Yung mga Pinoy, hindi naman arrogante yan. Most of us, hindi matangos yung ilong. Yung sa akin nga, hindi matangos eh. Pero may iba naman, mga guwapo. Right? Matangos yung ilong. Pero kung nasobraan naman sa pagkatangos, nagiging arrogante, arrogant nose, or bald men or bearded women, yung mga may bigote na mga babae, criminal inclinations po yan. Okay? This approach was utilized by Cesar Beccaria. Yun po ang interpretation, mga physiognomic interpretations po na example. So, tinitingnan yung itsura ng tao at ini-interpret kung may criminal inclination ba siya or wala. On the other hand, yung pangalawa, itong phrenology or craniology, pareho lang po yan. Ang physiognomy concentrates on the face of the person. Ang phrenology concentrates on the formation of the skull. Ha, yung ano po, yung skull po natin. Okay? So, sabi po dito, the study of the external formation of the skull indicating the conformation of the brain and the development of its various parts in relation to the behavior of the person. Ganito po kaya, kasi yan. Sabi po sa phrenology at craniology, may frontal lobe po tayo at saka may back lobe. Yung back lobe, yung sa back portion po, pag outward curvature po yan, ha? Curve ha, yung nasa likod. Ibig sabihin, fully developed yung mga emotional quotient ng tao, yung mga being humble, patient, generosity, hospitality, being respectful, yung mga EQ po natin yan dito sa back lobe. Sa front lobe naman, dyan makikita yung IQ po natin or intelligence quotient po. Now, ang concentration po kasi dito is yung nasa more on the backside. Kasi pag flat po yan, for example, pag mother po, yung babae is naka-flat lang po, walang outward curvature yung nasa likod niya. Ibig sabihin, ang babae na po na yan is considered to be unmotherly. Okay? Pero, pag outward curvature po, okay po yung pa-curve sa back lobe niya. Fully developed po yung emotional quotient ng tao. Ibig sabihin, motherly po yung babae. Okay? So, yun po ang what we call as phrenology or craniology. Okay? I am not saying this is true, ha? I am not saying this is true, but these are just theories and sometimes these theories gain a lot of criticism. But for discussion's sake, for the CLE's sake, yan po ang ibig sabihin ng phrenology or craniology at saka yung physiognomy. Okay? Alright. Alright po. I hope may nakuha, ha, mga first year cadets. Okay. Sa pagpapatuloy po, ang mental disturbances din can also result to criminality. Dalawa po ang klase ng mental disturbances. Can they jot this down, mga first year? Una, mental illness. Pangalawa, mental deficiency. Ang mental illness is something that can be treated in the hospital. Pwede siyang magbigyan ng lunas. Can be treated in the hospital. Number two, this is not inborn. Ibig sabihin, hindi po ito na carry over the moment you are born. Hindi po siya inborn. Okay? Mental illness. Pero at the opposite side, mental deficiency iba po. Opposite po siya sa mental illness. Kasi ang mental deficiency cannot be treated in the hospital. Number two, it is inborn. Okay? So, it is entwined with you the moment you are born. Okay? It is a condition of arrested or incomplete development of the mind existing before the age of 18 arising from inherited causes or induced by disease or injury. Okay? Mental deficiency po ang tawag. So, may mga classes po tayo ng mental deficiency. Una, idiots. Idiots po na may mental defect to a degree na hindi po sila pwede makapag-guard sa kanilang sarili. Against common physical dangers. Tapos yung mentality nila is comparable to a 2-year-old child. Imagine na, 2 years old. Pangalawa, itong imbeciles, comparable to the mind of a person which is 3 to 7. It does not amount to idiocy but is incapable of managing themselves for or their affairs. Pangatlo, itong tinatawag na yung feeble-minded woman. Yung person whose state of mind manifest cases where there exists mental defectiveness that do not amount to imbecility. O ito yung tinatawag natin kulang-kulang. Persons in this state require care, supervision, and control for their own or from others. For short, between the three, ang feeble-minded po, pwede pong they can actually follow household chores or errands. For example, pag mag-request ka to get a firewood, a feeble-minded person can actually get you a firewood. Pag sabihan mo yung feeble-minded person to fetch a pail of water, the person will really fetch, bibigyan ka ngayon ng isang balde ng tubig. Feeble-minded. But in terms of skilled type of work, for example, learning or probably computation, or maybe you ask them to cook food, medyo alanganin po kasi feeble-minded. Okay? Ang pangapat, which the less, is morally defective. Itong morally defective, di naman yan abnormal in terms to brain. Ang abnormality dyan, yung morality niya. Kasi po, ang tao na ito is considered to be incorrigible. Incapable of change po ito. Persons with strong vicious or criminal propensities, like for example, yung mga homicidal compulsion disorder. Yung hindi makapag-control sa kanilang sarili. Gusto talagang pumatay ng tao. Mga serial killers, for example. So in the case of children, they appear to be permanently incapable of receiving benefits from proper instruction in ordinary schools. Alright? Yan po ang classes. Now, punta tayo sa mental illness. Okay? Again, ang mental illness can be treated and is not considered to be inborn. Ang example, ang una po dito, itong tinatawag nating psychosis. Okay? Ang psychosis po, madali po yung intindihin. Ang phrase po dyan, keywords po natin, loss of contact with reality. Okay? Meaning, you detach yourselves from what is considered to be normal, what is considered to be a reality. Okay? Para maintindihan, ano ba ibig sabihin ng loss of contact with reality? Ano ba ang reality? Let us say, for example, pag gusto kang kumain ng saging, bumili ka ngayon ng saging, di ba? Kumain ka ng saging. Pero ang ginawa ng isang tao, ang kinain niya, yung peeling, yung outside part ng saging, tsaka yung contents ng saging, yung nasa loob, itinapon niya. Okay? Yung peeling yung kinain niya. Question, is it in accordance with reality? The answer is no. Kasi ang reality dyan, ang kainin mo yung nasa loob. Pag bumili ka ng candy, ano ang kakainin? Yung plastic or yung nasa loob? Of course, yung nasa loob. Pero pag bumili ka, yung kinain mo, yung plastic, tapos itinapon mo yung nasa loob, that's not basically in accordance with reality. So basically, you detach yourself from reality. Last example, pag nakipag-usap ka ngayon sa mga poste, sa mga kahoy, o kung ano-ano dyan, or sa bato, non-living things, for example, nakipag-usap ka sa poste or sa wall and pretend that the wall responds to your communication question. Is it in accordance with reality? The answer is no, because the wall will never communicate with you. The wall will never converse with you. So pag nakipag-usap ka, you are losing your contact with reality. Kasi ang reality po, makipag-usap ka pag tao po yan. Ha? Tao po yung kinausap mo. Okay? So, pag nakipag-usap ka dyan, nagka-loss of contact with reality ka. Psychosis po ang tawag. Now, ang psychosis, iba't iba po ang forms niyan. Okay? Iba-iba po ang klase ng psychosis. Una, itong tinatawag nating hallucination and illusion. Pangalawa, illusion. Una, hallucination. When we say hallucination, misperception po yan in the absence of an external stimuli. At the opposite side, when we say illusion, misperception po siya in the presence of an external stimuli. So, ibig sabihin, ang difference, simple lang po. Sa hallucination, walang external stimuli. Sa illusion, merong external stimuli. So, para maintindihan, ganito po ang example. Let us say, andyan ka sa room. Let us say, 12 midnight. Alright? 12 midnight, okay yung lights. Tapos, without your expectation, na surprise ka, nagka-brown out. Pag-brown out, nakakita ka ngayon ng white lady. Diba? Nakakita ka ngayon ng white lady, so, nagiging paranoid ka. You shouted out of surprise and nervousness kasi white lady. So kumuha ka ngayon ng flashlight para pailawan mo yung yung white lady. Pag kuha mo ng flashlight, itinutok mo ngayon sa white lady, it so happen na yung white lady pala is just a curtain inside your room. Curtain lang po pala inside the room. Yung curtain na po, yung curtain is the stimulus. You just misperceived the curtain. So, merong stimulus. Ano yung stimulus? Yung curtain. So, ano ang sinasuffer mo? You were just hallucinating. Hallucination yan. Naglakad ka ngayon, nakakita ka ng diablo. Pagtingin mo, oy, mayroong diablo. But in reality, when you really examine the object, it's just a tree. It's just a piece of a tree, a kahoy lang po, or a branch of a tree. But you misperceive it as a diablo. So considering na may external stimuli or external stimulus na curtain, so ano ngayon ang psychosis? Illusion. Illusion in a sense that merong external or misperception of an external stimuli. Pero pag pumunta ka sa isang lugar, nakipag-usap ka kung sino sa mga diwinde, sa mga encantada, or kung sino man yan, that do not actually exist. Yung mga normal na tao, tumitingin, nagtitinginan sa presensya mo kasi nakipag-usap ka by somebody that does not physically exist. Walang external stimulus. Wala po. Ang sinasuffer mo is basically hallucination. Okay? Kasi walang external stimulus. Alright? The other one is what we call as delusion. Ano ba ang delusion? It's just a false belief that a person holds on to without adequate evidence. Okay? It can be difficult to change the belief even with evidence to the contrary. For example, ang common po nito is yung persecutory. Yung magsasabi ang isang tao na I will not go out kasi may papatay po sa akin. Persecutory po. Or, di ba yung isang documentary video that was released in one of the TV networks, yung isang tao po tumira sa taas ng coconut tree. Doon sa niyog, sa taas po siya, doon po siya kumakain, doon po siya natutulog, doon po siya umiihi, doon po siya tumatay. Lahat po ginagawa niya doon po sa taas. Kasi po, pag delusional po kasi, delusion. He was suffering a delusion that if he will climb down the coconut tree, somebody will kill him. Delusion po yan. Or grando is person believing that they have special powers or skills. The other one is schizophrenia, alright? Ah, by the way, cadets, ang delusion po, dalawa po yan, ha? Primary at saka yung secondary delusion. Itong primary delusion, this arise suddenly and not being comprehensible in terms of normal mental processes. Let us say, for example, pag nagpa-haircut yung tao, after haircut, namatay siya pagkagabi. Diba? Usually, nagiging delusional yung mga members of the family or the neighbors. So, sasabihin nila ngayon, kaya pala nagpa-haircut kasi he is preparing himself for death. O, diba? Yun po ang mga type. Pag pumunta ka ngayon sa forest, tapos nakaapak ka ngayon, sa isang elevated soil, somebody will say na wag mong apakan kasi may nuno sa punso. But actually, that elevated soil, pag titingnan mo yan sa ilalim, wala pong dwarves doon. Ang nandoon are actually termites. Ha? Anay po, termites ang nandyan, hindi dwarves. Pero again, delusion po. Primary delusion po ang tawag. Secondary delusion po are typically understood as being influenced by the background of the person. For example, yung kultura natin, yung ethnicity, yung religious, superstitious, tsaka yung political belief. Let us say, for example, pag mag-board examination daw, ha? Pag mag-board examination daw is magdala ka ng itlog or mag-offer ka ng itlog kasi it's a blessing daw that you will pass the board examination. Nako. Tapos, dapat po, pag mag-CLA ka, mag-take ka ng board, dapat ang brief mo or yung underwear mo is color pula. Ay, nako. Ha, di ba? Cool, dapat color pula daw. Kasi you will pass the board examination. Nako, that is a form of secondary delusion. Di ba sa mga buntis, pag may eclipse, bawal pong lumabas? Kasi pag lumabas ka daw, yung bata mo would be handicapped when that child will be born. Yan po mga kind of secondary delusions po sa society po natin. Alright, letter C, schizophrenia. Ito very common ha, in our societies. For short, ang mga schizophrenia po, ito pong mga buang. Okay? Ang schizophrenia po kasi is a total loss of contact from reality. To the point that the person will be suffering from a combination of delusion and illusion or even hallucination. For short, ito yung mga taong buang. Living in the streets, ha? Living in the streets in our society na nakipag-usap to those persona that are not actually existing. Schizophrenia po ang tawag doon. Okay? Sunod, paranoia. Ang paranoia naman is a thought process believed to be heavily influenced by anxiety or fear, often to the point of delusion and irrationality. Paranoid thinking typically includes persecutory, similar po ito sa delusion, or beliefs of conspiracy concerning a perceived threat towards oneself. For example, everyone is out to get me. For example, an incident most people would view as an accident or coincidence, a paranoid person might believe was intentional. Okay? So, for example, you are playing a basketball, you were accidentally hit by the elbow of the opponent. Hindi po yan intentional. Pero, a paranoid person will think na talagang intentional po yan. Or another example, tatlo po kayo sa isang room. Ikaw nasa back portion, yung dalawa nasa front portion ng room. Wala yung teacher, tapos yung dalawa nag-giggling, laughing with each other and then whispering with each other. Ikaw yung nasa back portion, tapos paranoid ka, will think that the subject of the conversation is you. So magagalit ka ngayon kasi you are thinking na ikaw yung laman ng chismis sa dalawang tao na nasa unahan. But in reality, they were actually thinking about something else. Okay? They were speaking about something else. Hindi po ikaw yung topic. Pero ikaw paranoid ka eh. Ha? Paranoid person ka eh. So yun po, paranoia yan. Sunod. Other mental illness po, itong neurosis. Okay? Neurosis. Ang neurosis po is relatively mild mental illness that is not caused by organic disease involving symptoms of stress such as depression, anxiety, obsessive behavior, hypochondria, but not a radical loss of touch with reality. For short, the difference between neurosis and psychosis is very simple. Sa psychosis, loss of contact with reality. Okay? Pero sa neurosis, naka-attach ka lang sa reality. Normal ka lang na tao. Only that, you are suffering from emotional imbalance. Okay? Forms of neurosis po, itong tinatawag nating neurasthenia. Ano ba ang neurasthenia? Yung napifeel mo that you are depressed and then you are tired, di ba? Yung feeling mo na lagi kang in the state of tiresomeness or lagi kang exhausted, parang pagod, talagang pagod ka pero wala ka namang ginagawa. The moment you wake up, parang pagod ka na, di ba? And then you are depressed. Usually for a very long period of time, feeling of being depressed, feeling of being pagod, yan po, neurasthenia yan. And usually, it manifests fatigue and nervousness and sometimes pain. It is an ill-defined medical condition characterized by lassitude, nagiging fatigue, headache, and irritability associated chiefly with emotional disturbance. Kasi nga po, bakit ka nagiging fatigue, nagiging suffering from irritability and headache? Kasi po, you are thinking within yourself, you are keep on feeling that feeling na pagod ka, but in reality, hindi ka talaga pagod. Okay? It's just an emotional balance of feeling that you are tired and depressed. Okay? Next, anxiety. So anxiety naman, ito yung feeling of worry, nervousness, or unease, typically about an imminent event or something with an uncertain outcome. Di ba, karamihan po sa atin, pag may oral examination the next day, hindi tayo makatulog, we become too anxious. Ha, nagiging anxiety na yan. Or, parating na yung board examination, hindi ka ngayon kumakain, 3 times a day, kumakain ka lang, once a day. Nagiging stress ka because you worry a lot about what will happen in the board examination. May iba nga, teaching demo, nag-pass out, kasi po, walang kain eh, nagiging nervous, nagiging nervioso. You worry a lot. Ang tanong ngayon, rhetorical question, why do we have to worry? Diba? A lot of human beings in this world worry a lot about their future. They really wanted to become rich and wealthy. Gusto po natin, naging anxious po tayo eh, na dapat ganito po yan, na dapat po ang action natin should be in accordance with the label of the society. Dapat we have to prioritize po kung ano ang sasabihin ng iba. Less priority natin kung ano po yung gusto natin, di po ba? Yun po, na we tend to worry a lot on external things to the point that we give less value of our own happiness. Yun po. Dapat, ganito ba kasi yan? You have to be happy. May kasabihan nga, we are not living in the future, nor we are living in the present. We are living at the middle between present and future. Kasi nga po, we are at the present, but we worry too much on what will happen at the future. And when the future will come, di ba, we tend to worry, we tend to miss those happenings in the past. Di ba, pag bata tayo, gusto tayong tumangkad agad? Nung bata pa tayo, gusto tayo maging adult agad? Nung naging adult na tayo, gusto naman tayo maging bata. Diba? That's the complication, the complicated minds of human beings. Anyway, obsessive compulsive neurosis, another mental illness po. When you say obsessive compulsive neurosis, another mental illness under neurosis po ito, ha. Under neurosis pa rin. Ibig sabihin, obsession. From the word obsessive, obsession. Compulsive, ibig sabihin, hindi mo mapipigilan. That's uncontrollable. When we say morbid propensity po ang tawag dyan. Morbid propensity, ibig sabihin, uncontrollable impulse. You cannot control it. For example, kleptomania. Ano ibig sabihin ng kleptomania? Compulsive desire to steal. Dipsomania, desire to drink alcohol. Pyromania, compulsive desire to set fire. Homicidal compulsion, the irresistible urge to kill somebody. Napakarami po tayo mga morbid propensity. Ilan lang po ito sa mga examples po. Okay? Next, hysteria. I think everyone is familiar with the word hysterical. This refers to an unhealthy or senseless emotional outburst coupled with violent emotional outbreaks. Ibig sabihin ng hysteria, ha, unhealthy or nonsense na emotional outburst, ha. Nonsense. Nonsense po, unhealthy na emotional outburst. Ano pong tawag? Hysteria. Hysterical. Ha? For example, dumating ang isang Korean pop star. Korean pop star dumating sa Dumaguete City. Ikaw na hysterical, you cried out of joy. Parang nonsense, di ba? Or namatay yung Korean na idol mo. Umiyak ka ngayon. Kahit hindi ka naman kaanak. Is it with sense? Namatay yung Korean person na ina-idolize mo, tapos hindi ka kumakain ngayon ng isang buwan kasi namatay yung Korean, kaano-ano ka ba? Sa Korean na namatay. Diba? Umiiyak ka ngayon. Diba? Nagiging hysterical pa tayo. Diba? Tapos, another example, naka-perfect ka lang sa 1 out of sa 1 to 10 na quiz. Naka-perfect ka lang ha. 1 to 10 quiz. Nag-quiz yung instructor mo, perfect ka. Nagpalitsyon ka ngayon para mag-celebrate. Parang walang sense ah. Naging hysterical, 'di ba? Another example, sinabihan ka lang na hindi bagay yung suot mo. Hindi ka na kumakain for 1 week. It's a form of hysteria. Next, phobia, exaggerated fear of things. Normal po na may fear po tayo, nervousness over things. Pero ang punto po nito, exaggerated na sobraan na. Okay? For example, fear of blood, fear of needles, fear of height. Everyone fear the needle, everyone fear of blood. Pero pag nasobraan at to the point na hindi na normal yung mga behaviors mo, out of that fear, it's considered to be phobia. For example, yung iba nga makakita ng needle na nag-pass out. Okay? Kasi po may phobia. The other one is depression. Okay? Yung depression naman is a state of unpleasantness, despair, rejection, and hurt. Yung pinakababa na level po dito is sadness. Okay? Yung next level naman is depression. Yung feeling natin na we have been hurt, we have been rejected. Ang problema kasi sa depression po, biniblame po natin ang sarili natin. Okay? Sa mga tao who are prone to depression, this is my message to you, ha? Huwag kayong ma-depress. When you fall down, you shake off the dust, you get back up, you move on, and you move forward. That is life. You move forward, okay? Pag nadapa ka for 20 times, then you get back up for 20 times. You shake off the dust. You move on and you move forward. You do not stay on one page because life is a story. Do not stay on one page, my goodness. By chapter po tayo. Ha? After we are done with the one chapter of our own life, we proceed with the other. Do not stick on one page only. Ha? Do not be depressed. Magbasa ka ng Bible. Andiyan naman po yung Panginoon po natin, hindi po ba? The moment you kneel down, the moment you kneel your knees, and then you cry to God, you ask forgiveness, you tell everything, your burden to God, I tell you, gagaan po yung loob nyo, mawawala po yung depression na yan. Ha? Kasi yung mga tao, may mga depression, walang tiwala sa Panginoon. Pag may tiwala ka sa Panginoon, I tell you, wala po ang depression. Kasi po, you find peace. You find peace in God. Okay? So sa mga kapatid po natin dyan, ha, na mga criminology, first year, second year, third year, fourth year, even yung mga instructors natin, ha? Alright. Lastly, I'd like to dwell on sexual deviation. Okay? Sexual deviation po. And, alright, sexual deviation. Okay? When you say sexual deviation po, ito po ang type of mental disorder characterized by preference for obsession with unusual sexual practices. Ibig sabihin, ni-deviate ka. When you say deviate, you do not practice, you do not observe what is considered to be standard. Okay? Unusual po yung ginagawa. Ano bang standard? Ang standard is ang lalaki nasa taas, ang babae nasa baba. Siguro yung mga experienciado dyan magsasabi, sir, parang ano, di tayo masatisfied dyan ah. Tingnan natin ha, yung mga sexual disorder. Baka guilty kayo nito ha. Una, exhibitionism, a mental condition characterized by the compulsion to display one's genitals in public. I will not discuss more on this because it's very understandable. I don't want to be too obscene with the presentation. So, kindly understand it. Pag hindi kayo makapag-understand, tawagan nyo ako. I will call you and explain it again. So, exhibitionism, ibig sabihin, display one's genital in public and you love it. Number two, fetishism, a sexual attraction object to objects, situation or body parts not traditionally viewed as sexual. For example, na-attract ka ngayon sa mannequin, na sexually aroused ka. Ah, di ba? Number three, paraphilia, condition characterized by an abnormal sexual desire, typically involving extreme or dangerous activities. Di ba? You want to be sexually gratified? And you perform extreme positions, ah, di ba? Hinahang mo ngayon. Nilagyan mo ng PC nilagyan mo ng rope ang kamay ng isang tao, tapos you hang him 5 feet above the ground. Tapos ginawa niyo yung sexual intercourse. No, that's very paraphilia po. Pedophilia. Sexual feelings directed towards children. Remember, under Republic Act 2344, first year students, huwag po kayo magjowa ng below 18 years old. Kasi mga bata pa po yan. Under the definition of the Republic Act 9344. Next. Sadomasochism, sadism, and masochism. I'd like to emphasize on the three. Okay? When we say sadism, ibig sabihin, ikaw gusto mong saktan ang partner mo and you have sexual gratification. Okay? Nag-gratified ka, naliligayahan ka ngayon by punching your wife. Okay? You are the perpetrator. Ikaw po yung nag-perpetuate or nag-inflict ng pain and you find it very gratifying. Sa masochism, hindi ikaw ang nag-inflict, but rather you wanted to receive pain coming from your partner during this sexual intercourse because by receiving pain, you will be sexually gratified. Masochism po ang tawag. Ang combination sa dalawa, ibig sabihin, gusto mong saktan ang partner mo. At the same time, you wanted to receive pain from your partner during the intercourse. Ang tawag po dyan, sadomasochism. Combination po ng sadism at saka masochism. Okay? Next, transvesticism, also known as transvestism, is the practice of dressing and acting in a style or manner traditionally associated with another gender. And then voyeurism, watching others while naked, yung mga peeping tom dyan ha, or having sex, generally without their knowledge, also known as scopophilia or scoptophilia. Okay, peeping tom. Pag may boarding house, gagawa ngayon ng pinhole. Parang, kasi yung mga criminology, mahilig sa pinhole camera. Gumagawa ngayon ng pinhole para matingnan kung ano ang nangyayari sa other room. O, voyeurism yan ha. Okay? By the way, may anti-voyeurism law tayo. Itong tinatawag natin, Republic Act 9995. But in that law, ang voyeurism po, ibig sabihin noon, yung pag-record, pag-keep ng mga audio, video, graphics po ng mga scandals. Okay? Next, zoophilia. Ang zoophilia po, when you say zoo, ibig sabihin animals. Okay? Ang zoophilia po, tinatawag din po yung bestiality. Okay? Sexual intercourse with non-human animals. Okay? Pero actually, pag titingnan po natin sa psychology, iba po actually ang zoophilia at saka yung bestiality. Alright? There's just a very fine difference between the two. Pero, in other literatures, pwede po, these words can be used interchangeably. Yung zoophilia at saka yung bestiality. But technically ha, sa nagre-review right now, para at least technical po ang pag-deliver ko po sa discussion. Ganito po, pag zoophilia, meaning you have sexual interest with animals. Sexual interest po ang sabi dyan. Zoophilia. Pero pag you have sexual intercourse na, ang tawag bestiality. Kuha nyo po, mga reviewers. Zoophilia, nagka-sexual interest ka. You have been attracted sexually with animals. Gusto mong i-jug-jug sa yung kambing or yung ano, kung anong animals dyan sa backyard. Sexual interest, zoophilia. Pero pag nakipag-sexual intercourse ka na, ang tawag po bestiality. Alright? Next, sexual intercourse with relatives, ang tawag po dyan, incest. Alright? Other important terms, criminogenic processes, explain human behavior and the experiences which help the nature of person's personality as reaching mechanisms. For short, when you say criminogenic processes, ito po yung mga experience po natin. Mga experience po tayo nung bata po tayo and these experiences will shape our behavior. Okay? Kung ano po yung experience natin sa pamilya, yung mga experience na po yan, yan po ang mag-shape sa criminal behavior po natin or yung behavior in general. Number two, criminal psychodynamics, study of the mental process of criminals in action. When you say criminal in action, the moment a person will commit a crime. Ha? Istudyuhan kung ano yung nasa mental state ng tao. Di ba? Example nito, yung sabihin ng isang criminal na, "Sir, the moment I stab him, parang nademonyohan ako at dumilim po yung paningin ko." It's an example of the mental process of the criminal in action. Tawag po dyan, criminal psychodynamics. Alright? Next, dementia praecox, a collective term of mental disorder which actually begins shortly after puberty and leads to general failure of the mental faculties with a corresponding physiological impairment. Next, episodic criminal, ito yung non-criminal person who commits crime when under emotional stress. Okay? Next, melancholia, a mental disorder characterized by excessive brooding and depression of spirits. So, sadness, yung nasa unang level, second level depression, on the other hand, is melancholia. Megalomania, on the other hand, a mental disorder in which the subject thinks himself as great or exalted. Ito yung mga taong narcissistic. Mga taong they think that they are magnanimous. They think na mga magagandang tao sila. But in reality, they're not. Ito yung mga tao bang magsasabi na I am the reason why this project was realized. But in reality, hindi po siya. Siya yung center of, gusto niyang siya po yung center of attraction. Megalomania po ang tawag. Okay? I'd like to stop, cadets, with the slide. We will proceed with episode 3 po. Ligay po natin yung sa episode 3, yung remaining topics po under the subject. Maraming salamat po sa mga kadetia, sa mga reviewers po na mag-take ng board examination. Kindly pray, always pray. Keep on praying. Pray unceasingly. Ha? Pray unceasingly. Kailanganin po natin ang divine intervention in taking the board examination. Without faith in God, we are nothing. Without God, we are nothing. But again, faith should be entwined with initiative because faith without work is dead. So again, maraming salamat mga kadetis sa hindi nag-skip ng ads. Maraming salamat din po. Nakatulong po kayo sa akin at sa mga dialysis patients po sa Negros Oriental. Maraming salamat. God bless everyone.